interviews with all your favourite bands at planetloud.tv.
It's not just live, but also sort of these sort of stages and this kind of production. It's always a bit more sort of like bombastic.
Yeah. So our last tour was we called it the Cabin Fever Tour because the venues were so small. I mean, we were doing venues like 120 capacity on that, like, you know, sold out rooms, you know, full of kids going crazy. But this is, you know, thousands. Yeah. Plus capacity venue, so it's completely different. I mean, the stage at Brixton is about 10 times the size of the stages we've been playing on for the last few months. I mean, yeah, that we did a show in Colchester, so that was a big stage. But yeah, I mean, it's going from those different stages where you're like dodging each other's guitar necks, like flying past you, to then having all of this space around you, and then you can't kind of go crazy and try and fill it all, because then you look like a headless chicken. So you kind of have to work out how to make yourself look big, yeah, without, you know, sprinting back and forth, do you know what I mean?
To get try worn out.
Yeah.
Old man.
And you do get worn out easily, yeah.
Accepting some fans like, they just, I know what it's like. You go, you want to see a headline band, yeah, and you paid for the ticket, and you don't really, like, support bands are just an annoying thing that happens in between. But these guys have been really, really cool. They're there for like a show, they're there for, yeah, the spectacle of the whole evening.
I think the thing is, with same as our fans, I mean, if a band supports us, they are going to get, you know, they're going to be faced with an audience of people who are up for it, do you know what I mean? Yeah. And it's the same with Black Veil Rising, because both of our audiences are quite young, and younger audiences don't have those preconceptions. They don't have the cynicism. They just there to see some rock bands, and they're, yeah, excited to see whatever happens. And that's what's so cool about this tour, is that there's like a band like Attila, who are super heavy and almost got these sort of hip hop vibes. You've got Drama Club, who are dance, sort of full-on sort of house music, and okay, like playing stuff like Diantwop and stuff like that. You know, and it's a really varied mix, but the fans don't care, you know, they just here to see music, and that's the cool thing, and they're so accepting.
Well, this album especially, I think the two singles we picked were kind of quite, we thought about it, because it kind of, especially in the Young and the Dance Halls, like the first single was very, it's very theatrical, but it's got a sense of fun. It's quite heavy, it's got an incongruous riff, which was actually the working title for the album before we named it, Unbroken Hearts.
Yeah.
And it's just kind of, I think they're dark, but they're like intensely poppy, and they've like both got their kind of theatrical elements.
Yeah, the strings and I think, you know, we always set out to play music that emotionally, you know, dark music that emotionally moves you. And sometimes I think our music has a lot of comedy in it.
Okay.
I think I like music when you laugh because something ridiculous happens. You're listening to music and there's a ridiculous riff or a ridiculous
sort of thing that makes you do this.
Yeah, the sort of thing that makes you go, oh, that's hilarious. Like, and that's the sort of band we want to be. I think we're a dark, funny, you know, melodic band.
Okay.
I think we didn't completely find the true essence on our second album, because those two songs are probably the truest to what we really are. But we did go in 100 different styles. I mean, if you listen to the whole album, 16 tracks long, and no one song sounds the same. I mean, they all sound different. So I think we're still on the quest to really define what we are, but I think that'll be the next album. Um, I mean, the album's out on the 3rd of November, and we're gonna do like a Halloween show where hopefully we'll play a few more of the songs from that album. But yeah, I mean, we didn't wanna kind of overplay songs from the new album, because most of these people here, if they have heard us, they'll have only heard our older singles. So yeah, we thought, let's get as many of our singles in as possible so that they can just dance around them. You know, if they recognise it,
if they like it, they can look it up and it's actually there.
Yeah.
Rather than they're like, what the hell is this?
Yeah, exactly. So, you know, we will be playing, we'll do a headline tour next year where we play lots of stuff from the new album, but at the moment we're just keeping it to sort of greatest hits sort of set. Yeah, I mean, it's lighthearted in a way, but in a kind of black comedy. I mean, I created a world that all of our songs are set within called Grand Dominant.
Right.
It's like a conceptual sort of alternate reality sort of thing. So obviously that, I wrote most of the lyrics on the album in about 2 weeks. And so, the things that inspired me, other than the stories that the songs are based on, I guess most of it was just the struggle of what we're sort of going through as working class kids trying to be a successful rock band, you know. And you know, there's lots of other things on there, you know, sort of heartbreak and stuff like that, but that's the sort of boring stuff. But a lot of it was sort of politically inspired and sort of wanting to say something about this sort of climate and the world, you know, especially Britain that we live in today. There's a lot of sort of revolutionary sort of angst on this album. You know, just the way the poor are being treated, and you know, the way that this sort of blanket of protection seems to be falling over the rich. I mean, it's various things like that. But I mean, if you listen to the songs, you probably wouldn't even notice that. You know, you have to go in deep and listen to the lyrics. And that's one of the things that we love. We always make sure the chorus can be taken, you know, from any perspective, so that people can put their own feelings to the chorus,
yeah,
or to the song. But then there's really heartfelt songs on there as well about just gut emotions. You know, Kier and Luke, our drummer, wrote a song that's very sort of internal and very, yeah, you know,
introspective,
yeah. And then there's very extrospective kind of, you know, fuck the man sort of stuff. I shouldn't have sworn, I suppose.
Swear all you want.
Oh, cheers, thank you.
Yeah,
personal and sort of general, and looking at, you know, things that are happening, sort of, you know, the sort of disquiet that's happening in the Middle East and stuff like that. It inspired my literature, and then that kind of moved on to the songs. But yeah, personal as well. I mean, we all sort of grew up, you know, not impoverished or anything, but, you know, I grew up in a council house, and I've sort of seen this sort of stuff from both sides, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And yeah, just people that I'm very close to, seeing them struggle, and us struggling ourselves. Yeah. I mean, it's brilliant that I'm drinking beer, because that's on the right edge, you know what I mean? Like, we can get that, you know. I wouldn't normally drink Beck's beer. We normally drink Tesco Values sort of spirits, do you know what I mean? That's what we've been living off. So yeah, I mean, it's just, you know, I mean, it's self-imposed, really. We should, you know, being in a band, you kind of make the decision to live without anything, but still, you know, I guess, yeah, the lyrics are inspired by what we're going through, I suppose, yeah. Well, we don't notice, do you?
When you're in a...
Sorry about
this. When it's actually you in this situation, you don't ever really feel, doesn't ever really feel like that, because it's just you. Maybe some people do, but to us, you're always looking to the next thing, and you're always kind of trying to, you know, we have really people around us that are just really down to earth as well. Like, there's no way that I could ever get arrogant with my dad, for example.
Yeah.
Just like, oh, what are you doing, you little bastard?
Yeah, I mean, our families sort of stopped us, and we didn't, I mean, it didn't really feel like we were enormously successful, because we're not really enormously successful. I mean, we had a lot of hype, but we never had a record label or anything. anything. So we never had anyone giving us stuff, giving us, you know, making us feel special. Like, we still, even to this day, we load out our own gear from the van. Yeah. Do you know what I mean? We do everything that we've done since we were 16, 15 years old. We still do all that stuff because we can't, you know, we can't afford to have other people to do it for us. So, I mean, we kind of, I think, if anything, you know, you when it's happened to you, all you think about is what else you could be doing to make it, you know, to get further, you know. But yeah, we're just very, like, we're all quite insecure people anyway, so we never feel, I never feel important. I still feel embarrassed when people come up to me and say how great I am or whatever.
Yeah.
You know, because I don't believe them, you know. I kind of think, how can you think that about me, do you know what I mean? I do struggle with that a lot. So, yeah, I think, you know, but one day I'll hopefully have an opportunity where I can go, yes, actually.
Yeah, well done.
Well done. We've got a bottle of £300 champagne waiting in our fridge. A gold bottle. It's in like a gold leaf sort of bottle that we were given by our old management company. And we always say, when we get something to celebrate, we'll open it. And I guess we've had loads of things we should celebrate with that bottle of champagne, but we
want it to be a big thing.
A big thing. Maybe it'll never be.
We keep changing the bar.
Yeah, I mean,
this tour is a big thing.
I guess sort of headlining and selling out Wembley Stadium, maybe. Maybe we'll get to open that bottle of champagne. Yeah, it's a double-edged sword, because on the one hand you're like, yes, we did this by ourselves, but on the other hand, no one knows that, and you have to be happy with yourself, because everyone will immediately jump to conclusions. Whenever we're posted on Download's website, you know, saying that we're playing, or that we're on Kerrang's website and they're posting about our new album, you'll get 1,000, you know, not 1,000, but there'll be about 100 comments below saying stuff like, you know, this just shows that if you throw enough money into something, it'll stick, or, you know, you can tell these guys are just a man, you know, record label made machine, and all this sort of stuff. And I think it's kind of our fault, because we do try our best to make ourselves look professional. But I mean, it's all in-house. All of our t-shirt designs are done by us. All of our websites are built by our guitarist, Barone. I mean, everything we do ourselves. We now have management and booking agents and stuff. But it took a long time, you know. But Kier booked our last tour completely by himself. And, you know, we do everything ourselves. And I don't think people realise that, because they see a bit of makeup, they see that we care about the way we look, and they think that someone else has made us do that. We've done it ourselves.
Yeah.
So yeah, it is a big voice, yeah. So it's a double-edged sword. Yeah. I want to be recording and hopefully releasing our new album within that year. I'm not sure if we could. Another new album. We're releasing our second album in November, but we've already written about sort of 30 songs for the next one.
Okay.
So
it's not going to be 30 songs.
No, it's not going to be much more. Yeah, yeah. It's going to be much shorter than the last album. But yeah, so I want to be doing that. I just want to tour, like, because if anything that we've not been able to do as much as other bands is tour, because people are a bit fearless vampire killers phobic. I think they see us, and they see us on videos, and they think, I wouldn't really like to tour with those guys.
What a load of pranks.
Yeah, I think they think that we look like idiots. So we really struggle to tour with British bands. I mean, all of our support tours in England have been with American bands. A British band has never taken us out. We always take out our mates, you know, but they're all kind of in slightly smaller bands, you know what I mean? So, but we don't, you know, we have friends in the British sort of industry, with other British bands, but they never want to take us out on tour, so it's one of those things, you have to deal with it, but hopefully it'll mean that when we do get successful, you know, it'll be off our own backs, but we are probably going to be pretty bitter. yeah. I mean, I'd like to have a good chat with both bands, you know. Mm-hmm. We've been hanging out with Attila, we're sharing a dressing room today, and like, they're really, really cool down-to-earth guys. I'd just like to pick everyone's... I'd like to talk to the other guys and, you know, see, you know, how they deal with that, because I know Black Belt Brides have struggled with that in their whole career, is thinking that people hate them, you know what I mean? And a lot of people do, just because of the way they look.
Yeah.
We get exactly the same thing. And Attila are obviously this kind of strange concoction of, like, metal and rap and, you know. But they're bands that, you know, people love because they do something
they believe in.
That they believe in.
Yeah.
I think it's much easier to do stuff like that in America, I think, than it is in England. In England, people are very cynical, and they don't like you to be too passionate about anything. You have to be a bit aloof, and the more bland you are, the easier it is for you to get along in England, definitely. And that's why we struggle, I think.
We're just too interesting.
We're just too bloody interesting.
Reviews and interviews with all your favourite bands at planetloud.tv.